Hi guys, and welcome to Railways Explained. In case you watched the last three videos on Railways Explained, you could hear some great stories about the Eurotunnel, High Speed 1 in Great Britain, and the TGV system of France. The idea was to explore the potential of high-speed rail connections between the UK and continental Europe. Now, in a certain way, we came to the culminating moment of this series, the video in which we will discuss the overall effects of the construction of Eurotunnel. Before we jump into this topic, we would like to give you a brief introduction on the recent high-speed developments in Great Britain and France. The first phase of the TGV Nord service between Paris and Arras began in 1993. Eurotunnel was completed and put into operation in 1994. The same year, Eurostar started transporting passengers and goods through the tunnel. The second phase of the TGV Nord relating to the extension towards Eurotunnel was completed in 1996. High-speed Line 1, which connects Brussels and Belgium with the LGV Nord, was put into operation in 1997. And finally, the first phase of High-speed 1 was put into operation in 2003, and the second phase in 2007. Now, the opening of the Channel Tunnel enabled the traffic of Eurostar passenger trains, but also the operation of freight trains and the service Eurotunnel Shuttle, which is a roll-on-roll-off shuttle service for road vehicles, their drivers and passengers. It's important to also mention that both the freight and passenger traffic forecast that preceded the construction of the tunnel was significantly overestimated. We'll discuss that during the video. In order not to deal with the traffic performance of each year individually, we have again introduced a ramp-up period of 2 years, similar to what we did in the previous video. This means that, for example, since the first High-speed 1 service was introduced in 2003, its real effects could be measured only after the period of 2 years. Let's start with the passenger trains. At the time of a decision to build the Eurotunnel, the prediction was made that 15.9 million passengers will use Eurostar trains in the opening year. The reality, of course, was different. In 1995, the first full year of operation, actual numbers were a little bit over 2.9 million. Let's now look at the data for the other crucial years, sticking to the approach that we already mentioned. As you can see, the value of the forecasted 15.9 million was never reached in any year. But the numbers grew from year to year, and the construction of a new high-speed railway had significant impact on the exchange of passengers between the United Kingdom, France and Belgium. We must keep in mind that the travel time between London and Paris before the tunnel was 12 hours, and that the journey required both the trains and ferries. After the construction of the last part of the puzzle, second phase of High-speed 1, the travel time between these cities was reduced to astonishing 2 hours and 15 minutes. As you might guess, the pandemic and lockdowns in the UK and mainland Europe had a severe impact on Eurostar service. Eurostar has suffered the same harsh fall in passenger numbers as all other operators in the UK and Europe. But we could say that difference was the fact that while many European nations, such as France, have developed generous financial support programs to help businesses during pandemic, it was Eurostar's ownership structure that made it difficult for the two governments to do the same for Eurostar. Namely, Eurostar is not part of the UK franchising system, so the UK was not able to provide them with the state aid. Eurostar is in fact majority owned by the French state operator SNCF, investment firms and the National Railway Company of Belgium. So according to some news from the UK, Eurostar is now considered a French problem. But the French government, of course, did not want to be solely responsible for writing down the whole check. Anyway, Eurostar has finally managed to secure the necessary financial resources and maintain the service in the tunnel by securing a 290 million rescue package. The company will raise 20% of the money from selling stock, 60% through the loans guaranteed by investors, and 20% by restructuring the existing loans with the aim to reduce the current payments. Regarding the freight traffic, the first year prediction was 7.2 million tons. But the actual 1995 figure was only 1.3 million. We just must mention that the introduction of LGV Nord did not have any impact on the volumes of freight traffic, due to the fact already mentioned in our previous video. LGVs are reserved primarily for TGV trains. As you can see on the graph, freight volumes peaked in 1998 at 3.1 million tons. Then decline happened, going all the way down to 1.04 million tons in 2016, which was a historical minimum. Then numbers again increased, but as you can see in 2020, they decreased again. It was a pandemic and lockdown impact, but fortunately not to the extent it had affected the passenger traffic. Eurotunnel Le Shuttle, sometimes shortened to Le Shuttle or the Shuttle, is a railway shuttle service between the terminals in France and UK. This service is owned and operated by Getlink, the owner of the Channel Tunnel. This service offers passenger vehicle shuttle trains which conveys road vehicles, including bicycles and motorcycles, and passengers through the Channel Tunnel. Also, there are separate freight vehicle shuttle trains that conveys loaded and empty trucks. A Eurotunnel shuttle train is about 775 meters long, the carriages have a larger loading gauge than either British or French railways, and as a result they are not able to travel outside of the two terminals onto the national railways. Car shuttle trains for passenger vehicles have a locomotive at each end, with a series of fully enclosed vehicle-carrying wagons in between. Once boarded, drivers and passengers can exit their vehicles to walk around or use the toilets, but currently there are no onboard services. We will now show the data from 2005 to 2014, where we see a simultaneous display of the number of conveyed cars and buses, together with the estimated number of passengers. According to the data for this period, the average annual number of transferred cars through the tunnel was about 2.2 million and about 62,000 buses, which should not differ much from the average values for the entire period of the tunnel's existence. Based on the shown diagram, the average number of passengers transported by passenger shuttle trains was about 8.5 million per year. Freight shuttle trains carry trucks and conveys it through the channel. These shuttle trains also have a locomotive at each end and a single passenger wagon called the club car. Drivers load their own trucks onto the trains, and once they are in place and secured with wheel trucks, they are taken to the club car at the front by bus. The club car offers free Wi-Fi, toilets and vending machines with drinks and snacks. At the end of the journey, drivers are taken back to their trucks by bus so they can drive off the train to continue their journey. On the screen you can see data for the period 2005-2014, where we presented a number of conveyed trucks and estimated tons of freight carried by those trucks. According to presented data, an annual average number of conveyed trucks in this period was 1.3 million, which in transferred tons of freight amounts to about 16.1 million tons. Since the opening of the Channel Tunnel and start of commercial services from May 1994, more than 450 million passengers have traveled through the tunnel, the equivalent of three times the populations of United Kingdom and France combined. The above figure can be broken down into 242 million passengers on Eurostar shuttles and 208 million passengers on Eurostar. If we consider that the only competitive mode of transport between London, Paris and Brussels is air travel, and that the average occupancy of the plane is about 100 passengers, about 4.5 million air trips between these cities would have to be realized to carry the number of passengers who have traveled through the Channel Tunnel. In the context of environmental protection, we will leave this information here. According to the Carbon Independent Calculator, the CO2 emissions from aviation is about 250 kilograms CO2 equivalent per hour of flying. Regarding the freight, since the opening of the truck shuttle service in July 1994, freight shuttle trains have carried more than 30 million trucks and 385 million tons of freight. In addition to these volumes, we must add over 45 million tons of freight carried by freight trains through the tunnel since June 1994. This was a brief presentation of the facts of Eurotunnel on Railways Explained. For the end, we would like to thank all our patrons for supporting our work on Patreon. If you want to do the same, check the link in the description. And we hope you enjoyed and learned something new about the railways of the world. Don't forget to like this video, share it with your rail-loving friends, and of course, subscribe to our channel. Until the next time, goodbye.